because I work with her, we talk through the week. And of course, you can't talk to me about business or anything without the word and stuff coming up, because that's who I am. That's just how I do it. And I'm learning that. I don't need to walk around and say to everybody, I'm a Christian. Do you know Jesus? You know, if you live it and you walk it and it's in your life, people will ask you, do you know Jesus? Or they'll ask you, who do you know that makes you think and reason and talk the way you do? Does somebody here other than me know what I'm talking about today? They'll see it on you and they'll say, something about you. What is it? And rather they believe, see, people don't believe your doctrine. I've learned that the hard way. No, I've learned about Christians, I don't believe most of them. I don't like Christians. Because their doctrine most of the time seems to be absent their heart and presence. It's just their doctrine. There's no spirit behind what they say. It's their religious beliefs and conclusions, and anything that goes against that turns you into an instant enemy. And that's not what Jesus was about ever. Ever. You know, when the disciples came back and said, we saw people casting out demons in your name and we rebuked them. Jesus said, don't you ever do that. And he said something very, very powerful that day that I've been kind of thinking about for the past week. You know, these revelations come and I start to meditate. Whoever's not against me is for me. God has been messing with me this week about that. You didn't say whoever's not a Christian is against me. You said whoever's not against me is for me. Well, I've been in other religions and they're for you. No, I'm not trying to preach other doors and other ways. That's not what I'm doing. But I'm trying to say, Jesus is saying they're okay. They're on. At least they're good with me. Leave them alone. I got it. I'll work it out. Mind your business. You follow what I'm saying? There are people that believe that they don't believe he's the Messiah, but he believes he's the prophet to be listened to. Well, that's a start, doggone it. Then let them listen. Encourage them to listen. Talk to them about what you agree about and not what you disagree about. So I've had that conversation. Wow, so you feel that way about Jesus, huh? Oh, yeah. Tell me what you think about him and why. And then I'll tell you what I think about him and why. And let's have an intelligent conversation about the Jesus that I know and love as my Savior, and you know and love him as a prophet. And let's have a conversation. And all of a sudden, there was this gentleman who worked with me, and I liked him a lot. He was a Muslim. He was really, really serious about it. And me and him would talk, and I learned so much about the Muslim faith from him. You know, I remember being a Muslim when I was young, and I followed what I knew how to follow, but I didn't know what. Randy, you was a Muslim too. Remember, you used to wear the whole thing, yeah. So we wasn't playing. It was real stuff. And I remember some of the stuff, but I knew it was the tradition of what you were supposed to do and what you don't eat. And I mean, I stopped eating pork when I was a kid, and to this day, almost 60 years old, I still don't eat it. But these were things I learned about it. The reason I never went back to eating pork, please understand this, it wasn't because I was a Muslim anymore. It was because from talking to my Muslim friends and the people who were teaching me, I understood the value, the health values of it. So just because I'm a Christian doesn't throw out the fact that the other things that they taught me were true. Can I get a yes or something from somebody? You understand what I'm saying? There was truth to what was being taught outside of the theology. It was still the truth. So I kept that truth. Now, I don't go around telling you, you need to not eat that pork. It's bad for you to kill you. I don't do that. But I just didn't eat it. Now, from knowing this gentleman, he used to say to me, you know, here's the thing about Christians I don't like. And he would share from his perspective. And it wasn't hateful. From his perspective, it was the things he looked at and saw that didn't represent the Christ they said they served. And from his perspective, from the outside looking in, see, we could sometimes be myopic if a Christian sees it our way. Do I need to explain that? We can be more forgiving of somebody's flaws that's a Christian if they have the same flaws that we have. We're a lot more understanding of shortcomings in somebody else that we are not freed from. But then we're very, very harsh on the people who are still struggling with stuff that we don't struggle with. That fair enough to say? So then the Christianity didn't have sliding scales then, huh? Because it's holy and right if I don't struggle with it. So I know Christians who still struggle with fornication, but will chew you out for smoking a cigarette. I don't see any scriptures in the Bible about cigarette problems, but nonetheless, they found a way to divert from their issues to yours. Am I okay so far? So he began to talk to me about his points of view, and I would sit there and listen to him. I was a young man. I was about 18, 19 years old, and I would listen to him. Then I had the friend who owned the Army Navy store, and he was a Buddhist. Now, understand, I'm not a Christian at this time. I don't believe in any religion at that point. But I'm sitting there, and I'm absorbing from everybody their truth and what they believe and why they believe it. Then I went to the season where I spent a lot of time with Jehovah's Witnesses to find out why they believed the Bible so-called, but then the stuff they taught went against the Bible they said they believed. Because I was studying the Bible. And I was studying the Quran. You got to understand, I was studying. That's why when I stand up here and I say this kind of stuff, and you go like, wow, Pastor know a lot of stuff. Because I studied. And I didn't study to prove one religion right or one religion wrong. I just want to understand why people felt the way they felt and why they believed in this invisible Santa Claus God that they couldn't touch, and it didn't make sense to me. So basically, I was in a search to understand why these people believed in something that I didn't believe in and why they felt so passionate about it. How many of you would say you feel passionate about your relationship with the Lord? How many of you say, I believe in Jesus and he's my Savior and there's no question about it in my mind, I feel strong? Now, that's a good thing, but the scripture said, study to show yourself proof of work not, men need not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. But he said also says, be able to give an account for what you believe and why you believe it. Jesus told us this. So I can't just say, because I just know it. I need to be able to give an account. See, an account is not a statement. It's a breakdown. See, when the IRS asks for an account, when they want to see your books, they don't want to see your last paycheck. They want to see everything for the past year. They want to see, might seem want to see stuff for the past 7 years. You understand what I'm saying? If you're going to come to me and tell me your God is real and he is all of this stuff that you say he is, then you should be able to give me an accounting. Because I know by and by I may not understand. No, see, then you a religious person. Because if you have a relationship with the Lord, you should have ongoing situations that prove that you and God walk together. There should be something more than that. I remember when I got saved 15 years ago and I had a lump in my breast and he healed me. And that's all you got. That's your accounting. You have no record for the past year. You going to jail. You know what I'm saying? You doing something wrong. You cheating. You understand what I'm saying? Your accounting system is flawed. If you can't give me an account week to week, month to month, day to day of your relationship with the Lord and why. Why are you still walking with him if the last thing he did for you was in 1965? You follow what I'm saying? So what am I doing? I'm pushing something on you. I'm pushing something on you. I'm pushing. I didn't hit the clock. How long did that go on? Huh? Oh, that's okay then. We can work with that. So what I want to do today is I want to get people to share. And I asked Lindsay to share, and I'm sure she doesn't have an hour. I I doubt it. I don't want to use the word doubt. I'm pretty sure my hunch in the spirit is right. God is usually righter than you, so I'll go with him. Doesn't. No, I said does not. Yeah, okay. Okay. Communication is important. So I don't want to put other people on the spot because she had time to prepare, but I would like a few people to share up here on a mic, not from your seat, 5-10 minutes if you could, of what this whole book in Genesis and this whole Joseph story has spoken to you as a reality, as a wake up, as a truth. Because it's one thing to hear me preach and teach, but it doesn't mean anything if it doesn't become practical, useful knowledge to you. So I would like, so let me just see, without pulling teeth, who would be willing to take a few minutes and share the revelations from this message in this series that and what it spoke to them? And let me see. Okay, got a hand. So if you don't raise your hand, don't mean you're exempt. It just means you're going to be a hostile witness. You will be called. Especially if I think you've been here and you should know and have something to share. Because you don't want to pull me aside and say, oh, that really blessed me. Okay, don't think that flatters me because that does nothing for me. Zero, zip, zilch. So let me ask again, and then I'm going to let Lindsay share, and then I'm going to see who's next. How many people, as a result of this message, feels like I've seen a change in my life or this has taught me something and I want to talk about it a little bit? 5 minutes. Okay, so I will start picking. So, Aisha, you will share. Yes, you will. Esther, you will share. Yes, you will. Jackie, you will share. Yes, you will. And I'll see how the time goes and who else I'm going to pick. And somebody in the James clan over here is going to share something. Somebody going. Now, Mike, you've been grabbing me every week saying, let me tell you how this has spoken to me. So I don't see why you didn't throw both hands in the air and wave them like you just don't care. I don't. She's deeper. Okay. So, how old is the baby? One? I don't know if they do ones. You don't do ones upstairs, right? Okay. That's all right. You good, though. I just wanted to make you comfortable if you needed to be. Welcome. Never saw you before. Hi. We're real silly in here, but real serious at the same time. It's a beautiful place to be. You will enjoy yourself, I promise. So we're going to start the clock with Lindsay sharing what she has and the revelation she's got, and maybe that'll motivate you to remember, oh, yeah, that's right, I did learn that. And then you could kind of like twist it a little bit what do you call it? Not pilfer. What's that? But what do you call it when you take somebody else's writing and plagiarize a little bit? Thank you. You can sample and loop it and cut it up. Amen. Right, royalty-free loops. Here we go. Come on, let's share. Give God a hand as she comes forward.
Hello, how are you? Yeah, when I thought I heard Pastor say an hour, definitely I look back at you all like, no, I don't think so. I don't think so. You know, Pastor shared that he was, he said I was had time to prepare. And I've done a couple of messages here, and I would have my notes and my points and my summaries and my thesis, and I don't have that today. I just have my life and my heart. That's literally all I have. And so, amen. That was your instruction. That being said, the pastor and I were talking, as we do, and I started to share the revelations that God was giving me last week from the message, but this message has changed my life. And I say that, one, because it's powerful, but also I'm learning that, as when Edward shared, when we make a decision and a commitment to search God after Sundays, when we decide to take that responsibility, then any message can change our lives. And so I've had the opportunity to do that with this message about Joseph. How many of you guys have heard somebody's the Joseph in the family, or maybe someone has said that about you? Yes? A few people? Yeah. So, yeah, I used to think that too. But it was always the, you know, the Joseph after the years of being in jail and then getting out and going back in and being a slave. It was after. It was the end part. But what I've come to identify with is that I truly am the Joseph. And it's right now, this part of the story in my life, it's the beginning part that I'm identifying with way more than the end part. And that's why I can't prepare any notes. I just got to share my heart briefly, okay? So for these past maybe 12 months or so, this has been the absolute toughest year of my life as a Christian. I grew up in a house with a very strong, independent kind of spirit, and I was extremely insecure and got saved in college, but took that with me, all the insecurities. And over the years, I've built up walls and facades. And over these past 12 months, all those walls have been torn down. I think one of the reasons why I've identified with Joseph so much is because he probably had opportunity to humble himself and not have to be humbled as extreme as he was, but he didn't take those opportunities. And that's been me. So my humbling experience has been in front of all of you, in front of my family, just my life, just all the walls coming down. And I haven't had ground to stand on that I've been familiar with, so I've been learning from the Holy Spirit about his ground, and feel like I've been getting new feet, new legs, and learning how to stand and walk in humility. And Joseph, for those of you who have been here over the past few weeks, you hear the story of Joseph, how he was boasting in front of all of his brothers and saying, I'm the one, I had the dreams. And he did have the dreams and the callings. If you read to the end of the story, it all comes to pass, doesn't it? But it's that in-between part that I'm so grateful to God that Pastor has taken the time to walk us through, because it's literally changed my life. So I just want to share the revelation that I got. Okay, yes, Lord. I can't share that yet, but this won't be long. The reason why this message has been speaking to me so much is because I believe God has been showing me Joseph's personality through this. And he's been showing me his hurts and pains. And because of what I've been going through these past 12 months of being humbled, having to repent, having to acknowledge the fact that I'm not as strong as I've projected myself to be, I've been able to identify with that hurt and that pain in a way that most people around me, my friends and family, I don't think have ever had to experience. And so when Joseph was boasting and was thrown into the, sold into slavery, one of the things I was talking with God about, and then Pastor, is he didn't have the New Testament. He didn't have Psalms because David wasn't born yet, right? I think Joseph is like his great-great-grandfather. He didn't have Proverbs. He didn't have Ecclesiastes. What was he standing on in all of those years when he was in jail? What was he doing? And Pastor shared immediately, said Joseph was hearing. He was hearing God, talking to God, and hearing God. And I just started to compare Joseph's experiences to us, where we have access to everything 24/7, live, streamed, offline now. Everything can be downloaded. We have all this access, but yet really, what are we doing with it? What are we doing with all this word that we have access to, the Old Testament, the New Testament, 24/7? And I saw as Joseph was in slavery, then exalted, then thrown back into prison, there were a lot of emotions I'm sure he was going through that I was really starting to think about. And that's what I want to talk about real quick. If you could please turn with me to Genesis 40. Something. I think it's 41. Thank you, Pastor.
Pastor had already talked about in the message. If you guys haven't heard the message, I encourage you to go online and listen to the series. But he had talked about in 41:16, when Joseph said to Pharaoh, when he was brought out from prison after all those years, and Joseph said to Pharaoh, "I cannot do it," Joseph replied to Pharaoh, "but God will give Pharaoh the answer he desires." Now, if you're reading the story, that's a big turning point, because we know that Joseph was exalting himself, as I have been doing most of my life, and he was out of line for doing that. When you come back and when you're humbled, truly humbled, what I'm learning is that as the walls come down and you have to really own up to your mistakes, you realize that you're blessed to be a child of God, but your force or your strength in your own amount is extremely insignificant and not valuable. God can't work with us depending on our own strength or flesh. He can work with us depending on him to strengthen our flesh and to give us life every day. There's a big, big difference. I hope you guys hear that. There's a big difference. When we decide to take on all the responsibilities that we think we're supposed to do, or when we decide that we want to puff ourselves up to mask insecurity, what happens is we're telling God, "No, I'm not going to let you in this area." And it may not be out of our mouth, but our heart quickly turns, and before we realize it, we're hardened. And I don't want anybody else to experience that, and hopefully you guys won't ever have to go through what I've experienced, but that's what happened to me. My heart got so hardened that I wasn't able to hear anymore. I wasn't able to receive correction. And it got to the point where just a few months ago, I didn't want to live. I didn't want to live. And those thoughts came. What is life worth living for? What have you got? Just end it. And I'm a Christian. I've been saved for almost 15 years. And what I found is God will always reveal the source. He'll always reveal the answers. Sometimes we're not in a position to hear it, but if we can get ourselves in that place sooner than later, it's to our benefit. And I think what Joseph went through when he was in slavery, when he wasn't around people that he could necessarily boast to that knew him like that, then all of the air just kind of came out of the balloons. And he was just left with just a substance, just a piece of something, but there is no air, there was nothing for him to puff himself up to. And so then what happened to me, and I think to him, is he was forced to have to look at his insecurities because they were screaming at him. That deception wasn't there anymore. And so he had to look, and he had to deal, and he had to be humbled, right? Is this making sense? Okay. Excuse me. Sorry. I wanted to get back to the scripture. It's not easy being humbled. I get it. Correction doesn't feel good. But I was talking with God yesterday, and I said, "God, what's the end game here?" Because I have to acknowledge I've lost hope in a lot of areas, that there's been so much correction, so much humbling. What's the end game? And God reminded me of Joseph, how he obviously saved like his entire land, right? And then he fathered children that fathered David, that fathered Jesus. This is a pretty awesome end game. And so as I was talking with God about everything that Joseph went through and how he was lifted up, one of the things that God showed me was the place of praise that Joseph had from his pain, from his suffering. That's what I want to talk about, the revelation God gave me. Just to be clear, I'm not talking about suffering like, you know, not we know, right? The tone of this house, not suffering from lack or despair, but the place of him being humbled and literally having to be separated from everything about him that he knew to learn a new him, the God him. Does that make sense? Okay, so if you could go with me to Genesis 41, and we're gonna start at verse 46. We actually left off at 45 last week. And 46 says, Joseph was 30 years old when he entered the service of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And Joseph went out from Pharaoh's presence and traveled throughout Egypt. Now I'm going to just skip down a couple of verses. If you could go with me to verse 50. It says, before the years of famine came, two sons were born to Joseph by Asenath, daughter of Potipharah, Potiphar, priest of On. Joseph named his firstborn Manasseh and said, "It is because God has made me forget all my trouble and all my father's household." The second son he named Ephraim and said, "It is because God has made me fruitful in the land of my suffering." Those two places right there, to hear that God was not only restoring Joseph, but Joseph was actually acknowledging, I think maybe for one of the first times during this place, his suffering, the struggle, acknowledging the pain that he had been enduring and dealing with, even when he was excellent in his work ethic, even as he was humbled, even as he was, you know, literally deciphering dreams and visions. And Joseph cried out and said, "God, even in this place, you've delivered. You've given me hope. You've given me future. You have blessed me even in this place." And the main thing I identified with that is, you know what? Joseph did some really screwed up things, but he allowed himself to be humbled, and God used him and was faithful to his promise. And it wasn't that Joseph was left the same way he was. He was completely, drastically changed, y'all. I mean, he was a completely different person. And when you get to the, let me not speak we, I've gotten to such a low place in my life where I had this much hope and didn't care so much about physically living that I thought, what's the point? It just, you know, whatever. And in that place, I found myself there. I put myself there. God met me there. He took me, he's starting to take me out of that place. But in that place that I put myself to for my own actions, what I started to hear from God was, "I'm going to change you drastically, Lindsay. You're not going to be the same person. This isn't a temporary fix. I'm changing you. I'm giving you new footing. I'm giving you new foundation. The air is out of your balloons, yes, but you have a wonderful, beautiful land that I've always promised to you. Now let me take you to it. Let me manifest the dreams and visions that I've already given to you." Amen? I hope this is encouraging somebody, because when I look at my life and I see the love here that I've gotten from Pastor, from Minister Angela, and from many of you that I've spoken to over the past 12 months, I have a tendency to kind of do a comparison. And these past 12 months, the comparison has been, dang, I've screwed up a lot. If God can do it for me, he sure enough can do it for anybody up in this place. I don't care what y'all have done or what's gone on after Sundays. That's me. That's the way I think. But when Pastor started talking about Joseph, and I think I'm going to wrap up, the parallels to the spirit of pride, that rebellion, the boasting, all the things that we don't necessarily like to talk about, the insecurities, the reasons why we are the way we are, really having to look at them, I've been forced to have to look at that. And I've been forced over these past 12 months to have to own up to it. And at times I was still resistant. But what I'm finding is that as I'm turning to God, he's softening my heart. I'm hearing different. I'm hearing God speak. When I talk to Pastor, who has been my papa and just an amazing person in my life for the past 15 years, I can hear myself actually receiving and hearing in a way I never have before. And I can't take credit for it. It's just like my spirit, there's clutter that's been removed, and I can identify now and say, yes, that's me. Okay, I'll take it. I'll take the correction, I'll make the adjustments. It's not the end of the world, and I don't have to try and prove myself. There's no more of an agenda or a setup or a manipulation, which I've been guilty of for most of my life, to try and manipulate points or decisions or comments. It's just real, and it's God, and it's me, and it's my sins, and it's God healing me from them and correcting me from them. That's it. And it's the opportunity for people now to see that and to see the low places, and God has promised the higher places when we humble ourselves. He's promised to lift us up. He's promised to exalt us. It's not our job to exalt ourselves ever, ever. He's promised to do that. And so the second thing that is spoken, which I'm sure you guys are going to share, is Joseph's work ethic. Even through all that, he was sold at 17. He became the leader of Egypt at 30, and then for another 14 years before, that was 14 years before he met his family. So we're talking all that time of him in a foreign land. Imagine emotionally what he went through. Mentally, you got to think about those things. What was he dealing with? Was he facing the same thoughts of just giving up? What was he feeling? What caused him to be consistent in his work ethic? But at night when he went to sleep, was he crying himself to sleep? Was he thinking about his family? Was he wondering how he could have done things different? I've been doing that. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. Jesus, but sometimes it's necessary for us to be able to say, I humble myself now. I think things are good, God, but let me humble myself now so you can check me and heal me and cleanse me so it doesn't have to get to the point of a Joseph. Amen? Amen? Thank you. Thank you so much, Pastor.
Good job. And that's what I told you. I said, don't get up there and try to teach. And that's what I'm going to say to you guys. Don't get up here and try to teach and be deep. Share your heart. Share the truth that you've seen. Before I pass the mic to the next person, I do want to throw this out there, and this is very important. I sat down with my wife day before yesterday. I said, I need to talk to you. And she said, something bothering you? And I said, yes. Just so you know, you're not alone. I said, what is it all for? I don't feel like killing myself. My life is really, really good. But I start to feel like vanity. All is vanity. You know, I said, okay, so if I continue to succeed in this business and this thing that go and I get millions of dollars, so what? You know, I begin to say, so what? I don't need another house. I don't care about cars. I don't want a Maybach. I don't want bling bling and yachts, and I don't want to live that life. That doesn't mean anything to me. And I begin to share with her about the evil that you see in the world. I mean, we're so caught up in Trump, and go some other places and where there's no justice, no justice system, and the evil that happens in this world just without restriction or restraint. And my heart just was broke. And I said, this world is evil. I don't even want to be here. I don't like it. Like, why, you know? And I know the word of God says, because, you know, God is patient that everybody will be saved. And I'm like, God, I don't know if it's working. You know, can we just wrap this thing up? You know, I was going through this feeling of, anybody other than me ever felt like that? Like, can we just check out and just get over with this thing already? And so I kept saying, well, if I need to be here longer, you ready for this? I said, God, I need a new why, because I think I wore the other one out. I need to understand my why. See, knowing what to do is fine. But for me, I need to know why I'm doing it. What am I here for? Because this is to be successful, that kind of stuff don't mean nothing to me. I'm very successful. I'm blessed. Everything I put my hands to, God bless. Now, I don't go to my bank account and open it up and see, you know, $500,000 just floating there waiting for me to take it. But like that oil in the mail, I know if I pour it out, it'll be refilled. I'm good. My needs are met. So I begin to think, God, I lack nothing in the natural. I don't feel like I lack anything in the spirit, but I feel like I lack a new purpose for what to do with what you've given me. So that should be, at some point in our lives, a question that comes up. If not, you're self-absorbed. You really are being a Christian in the sense of the religion, but you're not walking with God. Because the hunger of God consumes you. It makes you begin to cry when you look at the world. It makes you begin to hurt when you see the lost. If all your prayers are still about you, me, how do I pay my, how do I get this, how do I get a raise, then your Christianity is a sham. We go into the world and we preach the gospel. And it's not necessarily saying you need Jesus. That's not preaching the gospel. The good news is preached not so much by what you say, but how you live that makes people want what you have. That's all I want to say on that. So, yeah, Lindsay, I come to that place too. And if you're really walking with God and seeking God out about yourself, no matter how good you think you are, no matter how holy you think you are, no matter how much you think you accomplished, once God gets you under that microscope, you start to feel like I haven't accomplished nothing. You can be feeling real good about yourself just before that prayer, and then all of a sudden you're like, So, feel good. I want you to feel good. Feel excited about your life. I want you to feel excited. But if you're not coming to that place from time to time that you're questioning your worth on this planet, you've become self-absorbed. You may not agree with me, and I don't care. My point is it's still true. We're here to serve God, not to ask God to serve us. We're here to see what God put us here to do, not to see what God can do for us. And he blesses us as we do for him. Amen? Because we get it backwards. We think that's what we're here for, to figure out how to pray to move the hand of God. See, there's a way you pray to move the heavens. Like, God don't need you to move his heavens. He don't need your help. Serve him. Do what he's called you to do here, and let him do his own moving.
Praise God. Lord, I pray that you just guide my words and that your will be done this morning. What I took from this whole sermon about Joseph was from the beginning, where he started, him being the youngest son, and the turmoil that he went through, and he was able to rise, continue to rise. And it was encouraging, and it just kind of, and that was something like my grandma always kind of said about me, if you know my upbringing or whatever, she says, that you're blessed, and you always found a way to rise. And growing up, my friend, can attest, the friend I brought with me today, I lived a different life, and at one point, I had no kind of similar. I had no hope for my life. Growing up as a kid, I didn't think I'd be this old. I didn't have any hope to make it past 15. And then past that, things that we got into, whatever. We didn't really think about what's gonna come later on. I'm grateful to be here today. And I thank God for it every day. And just to see the growth, like from where I used to be, to where I am now, what kind of person I am now, what kind of person I used to be, the things that I felt that was important, and you just even, going from job to job, like these things I've been seeing in the past couple of years, just trusting in God. I kind of had a similar story to what you had with your previous employment, I used to be in the car business, and we used to work on Sundays, and when I first started a job, they wanted to make me a manager, and one of my friends, he's another Christian, and he was saying, let's make a petition to get off Sundays because everybody works on Sundays and we don't have a chance to praise God. And I was like, I just came here, I don't know if I should do this, but something my spirit was leading me and said, I signed a petition. So we signed a petition and we consecrated it. And the manager, the boss heard about it or whatever, because he has cameras all throughout the building or whatever. And he was like, I'm hearing about this petition. He had a meeting. He says, we're not having Sundays off. I don't think, does anybody know anything about his petition? And because he put everybody on the spot, nobody really wanted to say anything, because in the car business, it's a revolving door. You get fired like it's nothing, so. Nobody said anything, so I just felt compelled to say it. And that messed me up, because I just started a job. I was supposed to be a manager, So I was under the microscope for a while. I was a regular salesperson, looking ways to get me fired or whatever. And, you know, after a while, months went by, you know, I went from a man, went from a salesperson, then I was doing well, I was exceeding, and I was one of the best salesperson, one of the top earners, you know, despite how they tried to stop me, despite how they didn't approve my deals, you know, God is good. You know, so my manager was so despicable, he couldn't fire me because I was doing so well, he had to move me to a different department. And there was nobody else there in that department. I went to service sales, and there was no salesman there, and he made me a manager of that department. And I had my own schedule, and I had Sundays off. And I went to work whenever I wanted to go to work, you know, so God's been doing this all throughout my life. So, you know, that story of Joseph, man, just, you know, it's just trusting God, you know, and he'll take you through. And I've seen that time and time again, and that encourages me. You know, it's a testimony to me. You know, I'm sure my friend could talk on that too, you know. But yeah, I'm grateful. I'm grateful. Amen. Amen.
Let me ask you a question. Did you used to rap? Used to be a rapper? Because you held the mic like this. That's a giveaway. That's a rapper giveaway. That's a giveaway. Right here. You can tell immediately that's right. Because in the playground, we had them cheap mics. And they have good quality. So to get more bass, you hold it like that. That's see. I was out there, I know. You know, that's why. You hear the difference in the sound? That's why. They went there, oh yeah. Come on, Aisha. Give God praise as she comes.
The story of Joseph really helped me because in 2015, there was this big scandal at work and they tried to take my job. At the same time, I was studying to get a promotion to be a captain at my job. I wanted to give up and not take the exam, and Jermaine pushed me. We studied, we went to class. I had the same people that did the scandal I had to work with. Mm. I had to see them every day. And sometimes I just didn't feel like going to work. And at one point, I didn't feel like I needed to even be here anymore. But I would come to church, speak to pastor, pray. He would pray with me. And not only did I pass the captain's exam, out of 202 people, I was number 24 on the list. The position I had as the warden's secretary, I stayed. They didn't get me fired, and I'm still work for the department. And I had to get a lawyer, but I can't get into all that right now. But the lawyer that I did get, there were people that told me that, oh, you know, you shouldn't get a lawyer or stick with the department's lawyer. But the woman that I have now is amazing. So I'll finish the story after all of this is so done. Sir. Yes, but the story was like, yes. Yes.
Yes, gotta share that.
Yes. So I just want to say the story of Joseph actually was like.
He wants you to tell it.
Say that again?
The people that tried to get you pushed out, remember? The people that wound up helping you get your promotion.
Yes. I have to help them every day, yeah. Yes. Right. And I was.
Maybe you
them.
Need to come up here. Come on up here. You come stand up here. Yeah, there you go. That's what I'm talking about.
Come back. Listen, I got you.
Thank you.
What I was trying to say is the same people who hurt her, who started the scandal, are the same people who she's required to help at her job. So she went to work every day, strong, and continued to help these same people who tried to get her fired. And she's still doing it up to this day. She wanted to quit. She wanted to forget about the promotion. I told her, no, God has plans. We're gonna keep pushing. We're gonna keep studying. We both passed. She scored a lot higher than I did. She was number 24 on the list. I was at the bottom of 121. out of 202 people. But I told her, it's not over. It's not over. Even times where an average person would just give up, Aisha knew, no, God has her. And this is not over. And I said to her, we're going to continue to fight this to the very end because God is going to lead us to the light at the end of the tunnel. Yes.
Amen.
All right? Amen. I love you.
I love you too. I love
you too, man.
I'm down on this one. I'm doing this one. Listen, I said I'm a green light on this one. I'm involved in this one. Listen, just let me know. I got my tux ready. Amen. I love hearing those kind of stories, man. See, that's the stuff that let me know I'm doing something right. Hallelujah. Come on, Esther. Don't be hiding back there. Hi.
What the heck? Anointed.
Hi. Thank you, God. All right, well, thank you. right. So the story of Joseph, what spoke to me was, I had mentioned this a couple of weeks ago, how at the beginning he would always say, I, there was a lot of I going on. His father had given him a coat of many colors, and I wouldn't be surprised if he, you know, showed it off to his brothers and said, na-na-na-na-boo-boo. look at me, look at this coat, my dad loves me, you know. And then he finds himself in a position where he's in jail and where he's accused of doing certain things that he didn't do. He was sent to interpret a dream, and I'm sure that back in the day he would say, I can interpret this dream for you. I can tell you what this means, you know. But after having gone through all the suffering that he did, the many years that he went through, he got to a point where he actually said, okay, I can't do this. God's the one who can do this. God's the one who can interpret this dream for you. So just what really touched me was the fact that he was finally humbled, whether it was his own decision or experience that got him to the point where he would say, okay, no, I can't do this. God's the one who can do this. And that's kind of like, I guess, where I am. There have been times when I would make plans, and I would say, this is what's gonna happen, this is where I wanna be, I'm gonna do this, this, and that plan, which is good, but God would say, that's nice, but this is what I'm going to do. Like, and what he had done was so much greater than what I could ever imagine, you know, what I could ever expect. And all that to say, just to God be the glory. You know, in everything that I've done, I'm going to make a list of the great things that has happened in my life and reflect on those things and know that those aren't my doing. That's God that's been working in my life through pastor as well, through all, like, the many the many things that we've yes, the many encounters, the many things we've spoken about, the tears and all that, that's God. And I'm very thankful for what God has done in my life. And I know that it's not me, it's him. And I'm looking forward to so many more things to give him glory for, first and foremost, to God be the glory.
You know, there's nobody else, right? It's just, I don't know. I just want to say, you know, it's interesting for those of you who weren't here for the whole message, just a couple of points. One, Joseph was the youngest of the 12. The older was Reuben, right? Is that? No, Benjamin was after, he was sold. But you're right in the order. He was the youngest of the brothers at the time that they sold his behind. That's what I'm saying. So he's the youngest of them, and Reuben was the oldest. And Reuben slept with one of the concubines of his father, and as a result of that, the father punished him by taking his birthright and not giving it to the next oldest, but pushing it all the way down to his youngest, putting a coat on them of colors and parading them around as a kind of a slap in the face. And the brothers, of course, he put them in a place, I'm sure, when he became a brat. I don't know if you ever had a brat sibling that you used to say, my mom wouldn't let me get away with that, and look at them, right? So, come on, a few people said shucks, so you know what I'm talking about, right? And just like, you know, I would have got smacked in my mouth for that. And you, look at her. She just, you know, and it creates her anger. That was a loud It creates an anger. It creates a frustration amongst the brothers. But to the point, here's the thing, to the point that they wanted him dead. Now, that's some serious animosity when all 10 brothers in agreement decide, let's kill him. And it was the older brother that stepped in and said, no, let's not kill him. Let's sell him as a slave. Woo! I mean, but still, even in that, unanimously, let's get him out the family. So this Joseph had to be a real pain in the behind. He had to be the apple of his father's eye and knew it. And so when we think about the process of what everybody keeps seeming to bring up today, where him getting to the place of going, no, I can't, but God can, and all the stuff in between, and like you said, you need to listen to the messages. What's the title of the message? I forgot now. Call to Favor? Thank you. Call to Favor series. Yes. Go on. It's on iTunes in the My JCMINC podcast. And it's on the website at jcminc.com. .org. Thank you. So no excuse. Listen and again and again and again. Thank you, Ruth, for your work with the rest of the media team to get us on podcasts. We love you for that. Yes, we do. I love the podcast. So with that said, hi, Jackie. You ready? Come on.
Good afternoon, everybody. In regards to Joseph, for me, no matter what, Joseph was blessed. No matter what he went through, he was blessed. And he was able to be a blessing to his family in the end. I don't know if anybody knows, but God has put a calling on my life. And he has told me a while back, and I ran and ran and ran. But nothing was more to me than what happened the past 2 weeks, because I was sick. I was in the hospital for 6 days. And even in the hospital, God has showed me my calling in the hospital. I didn't even think, my mind was, I need to breathe. You know, I need to breathe. And it so happened that when I finally got the room after like 26 hours or so in the emergency room, I'm already admitted waiting for a room, I get a room, and the person who comes up in the room is another woman. I was like, Lord, I just hope I get a good roommate, you know, why I'm here to heal. And this woman comes in, and she was there for 5 days with me. And through our communication there, she got saved. She got saved. And the thing was, God put Joseph in a place. Even though he went through what he went through, he put him in a place. And God put me, I'm not saying that God made me sick, but in the place of where I was, he put me in a position to do what he called me to do. So it doesn't matter where you think you are, but where God puts you is a position to do his calling. It's a position to do what he wants you to do to save this other person. So it'd be a domino effect, and to show the goodness of God, to show what God really means and what it is to worship God, what it is to praise God, what it is to let other people know the goodness and the love that God has for us. So, and that's what he has installed in me, even growing up. Love is my life, because I can't not love somebody, different race, different religion, different color, different creed. I cannot not love them. I could be upset, but I can't have malice against nobody. It doesn't stay in my heart no matter what. So I think that is what God has put into me. But the person going back to the hospital, she said to me when she was in the waiting room, just like me, all those hours, and we never saw each other, that she prayed to God and talked to God and asked God, what is she going to do with her life and what she was going through in her life, and that she, what she was going to do. And when she laid it down and told me, and God put me in that place to her, to minister to her, and we both in a hospital bed. And I just give God thanks and praise. And she was even going through stuff in her life that had to deal with her children and her family and her finances. And I was still able to minister her and to show her how she can do certain things and how she can get certain things. And she was writing it down in a book, and so she can go back to it. And I even told her about JCMI. And I just want to thank you for the principles that you have showed us here over all the years. I've been a member of this church 15 years or so. Long time. From the time we were at the school, you know. So thank you. Thank God of what was installed in me, you know, as just a person, so I can actually walk into my calling. And I just want to just give God praise and glory and just thank him, because it's, once you say yes, doesn't mean you say yes sometimes. You want to say yes in your spirit, but in your flesh, it's like, okay, yes. But when God start talking to you and start ministering to you and start telling you what you've been charged with, which he did to me before I went to hospital, and what you're charged with and what your calling is and how he wants me to do it and what he wants me to learn, and it changes your perspective on life. It changes how you see things. It changes how you do things and how you speak and how you speak to others. And that's how people know that God is in your life, and what they want to know more of you and where you get that from. So that's what happened to me. And that's just another confirmation of even me being in the hospital with the mask on and the IVs and person next to me, and we're still sharing with God, and she still gave her life to God. So now she has children, she has 5 children. She can show that to her children and her family. So it's a domino effect of blessings. So we don't take it lightly or take it for granted that we are Christians, and not just to say we're Christians. No, Christians mean love. It means love. No matter what you are, it's always love conquers hate. Whatever's going on now in this world, love conquers hate. Yeah. So that's kind of it. So thank you for your time. Okay.
I was getting ready to jump on the organ. You know, so I don't know how to play that kind of organ, but I was going to try it. My God, my God, my God. See, it's good to know that people are hearing the word and it's making a difference. That's what this is about. Other than that, I'm just standing up here putting on a show, and I'm not about that. Well, we've run out of our time, but so if you got away from having to come up, you got away. But I think I got everybody I called, and there'll be other times. So this is just not the last day. Jackie said something very, very powerful here. And if you look at the message right, everywhere he went, even in his dire straits, he still was seen by everybody around him to be blessed. Everything he did still prospered. He didn't lay down in a ball and feel sorry for himself. He kept doing the work. It's interesting because you listen to the stories and you see the personalities. Jackie said, "I didn't even know you were in the hospital." So, you know, there's people call me up when they got a headache. You in the hospital and don't even bother, Pastor. Look at that. You know where your God is. You didn't need to. You know, that's powerful. We need a bunch like you. A whole church like that, no pastor would ever have an issue. Now, then you hear Lindsay's story. You hear my story where I'm questioning, well, what am I here for, what I need to do? And I'm asking, Lindsay's saying, I feel like I just want to die. And you see the different phases of growth and the dynamics of, she immediately said, okay, I see why I'm here. I have a job to do. Not God put me here. Whatever choices or whatever lifestyles or whatever put you there, God said, I'm going to get you to do what I called you to do. I don't believe God put Joseph in jail. I believe his mouth put him in jail. I believe his arrogance put him in jail. But while you're in here, see, I may not have been in physical jail, but God has put me in jail at times that he couldn't get me to obey his word and humble myself where I need to and surrender where I need to and repent where I need to. Or somebody other than me know what I'm talking about? You know, it felt like jail, may not have had no bars, but oh my God, everything around me felt like jail. Because when you're in that place where you won't move where God wants you to move, he will allow the circumstances to move you there. And it's usually not fun. It's usually not fun. So I'm learning at this age of my life, I don't know about you, but I don't want to go through stuff no more. I just want to obey and do what God called me to do. I don't want to learn in the cell. I don't want to learn bored up in my closet in pain, questioning, did I really hear or not? I just want to obey. And let me just say this to you in closing, and this is a good closing place. Trust me, it is. Pain is pain. I know that don't sound deep, but it's cool. And pain hurts, in case you didn't know that. Pain hurts. But here's what I found. There's two types of pain when you're walking with God. There's the pain that comes through the change in being obedient. I would call that more discomfort than pain. And then there's the pain that comes from disobedience when you're forced into the situation to do what God has called you to do. Either way, you come out on top, but one just hurts a lot more. So I'd rather take the pain of correction. So when I had to go where I had to go last night and I prayed, God, I really don't even want to go, but I know I have to go. So give me a right heart. I had to take a deep breath and walk in there and decide to love. And God showed up for me where I could have stayed in that place and sat home with that thing still in the pit of my gut. You understand what I'm saying? Still eventually having to face it, probably by being forced into it. Oh, I'm speaking to somebody. So I'm learning to say, God, I'd rather take the discomfort of being corrected than the pain of being judged. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you today for your word. We thank you for everyone who shared. Ask you to continue to pour a blessing on their lives. You heard the cry of each one of them and their desires. to be better, to be stronger, to be greater. Father God, I thank you for allowing me to teach this house in a way that one after another, people are getting up crying out to be better and to be greater and to be closer to you. That nobody got up and claimed stuff, but they're claiming the real stuff, the stuff that all stuff comes from, which is your spirit, your presence, your direction, your voice, your face, Father God, that we want to know you better. We want to be used by you. And if you agree with me, shout amen. We want to be used by you, Father. You heard the amen. We want to be in your service, Father God. We want to be everything you've called us to be. We don't want to be fettered by this physical body or our physical needs or our physical emotions. We are bigger than these things. We are better than these things. We are greater than these things. We are called to something mightier than this. And we refuse to be just average lay people anymore. We are here with an assignment. We are here with power. We are here with purpose. We are here with destiny, Father God. I pray for the anointing of destiny to begin to sit on each and every person in this room right now. I pray that the desire and the hunger for the greatness you've called all of us to rise up in us right now, where we will not settle for being mediocre and average in church folk, but that we are called to a huge thing, a big thing, bigger than what our minds can comprehend. And whether it's been a year or 5 years or 10 years, it took Joseph 40 years, it took Abraham probably more than that to see the manifestation of what you showed him. Father God, whatever it takes for us to be in line, to see what it is you've called us to, we accept that right now. We humble ourselves right now to that very truth, Father God, that what you called us to, we shall not be denied. We are your people. We are your people. We are your people. We're not church people. We're your people. We're not Christian folk. We're your folk, Father God. Christian is a title. We are your children. And we thank you, Lord, that your anointing lives on us, lays on us today. As the deer panteth for the water, so our soul longeth after you. Not what you can do, but after you. Father, we seek after you. We seek your face. We hunger for your touch. We desire, Father God, to be in your perfect will. Teach us how to be used by you. Some of us, we haven't learned yet. We're still trying to figure out how to use you. Teach us how to be used by you. And we thank you, Lord God, that everybody here today, under the sound of my voice, accepts that truth as a reality. We thank you, God. And we bless you, Lord. Oh, just talk to him a little bit about who you are, where you are, and where you want to be in him. Just talk to him.